Thanks be unto God for his marvelous goodness and grace. He knows what he's doing in this day. There are a lot of questions that we could ask of why God works the way that he does. But in the end, it comes down to our trusting him and putting all of our faith, all of our hope in his word. So we know that there is a benefit in his word, and that's what we're doing today, getting into the word until it becomes alive in us. That which has been written down in the past on stone tablets in the covenant of Moses, now the Lord is writing his word upon the fleshly tables of our heart until it becomes our nature. And surely it is our nature in Christ, but he's having to rewrite that nature of the old man that it might reflect the image of the incorruptible seed of the living word of God. And we know that just reading the Bible isn't going to do it. I pray that we spend time before the Lord, that we seek his face. I know that John, who wrote 1 John, wrote some of the other books that were epistles in the scripture. These men were isolated. John spent years on the Isle of Patmos. Paul spent years in prison. And this was probably not their choice according to the flesh. No one wants to be jailed. No one wants to be captive. But God uses these things that we might fix ourselves, our attention, our focus, our energy, all of our strength, that we might put all that we have into and toward the purposes of the Lord Jesus, that he might have full dominion in our lives. And that's what we're talking about this morning. The prayer of the saints, the faith of the saints, that we might continue in those things that are of God. Here in 1 John, starting off in 1 John 5, starting off where we left off in the 14th verse. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. Well, we're coming out of times and days past gone by where people believed in the name and claim it gospel. This was just you tell God what you want. And then if you have the faith for it, he's going to give it to you. And the scriptures were used and misused and abused to appease the fleshly and carnal appetites of men. Though they knew God, they were using God to get what the flesh wanted. That does not represent the reality of the seed of the living word of Christ. Jesus said, "I do nothing of my own. Everything that I do according to the will of the Father." Jesus said, "I can't do anything except I see the Father do it and except I hear the Father speak it." And of course, no man can see God, no man can hear God, except the Spirit make it real and the Spirit make it evident. So Jesus was talking about a complete reliance upon the Holy Ghost. And this is where the scripture in itself, this word that's written down, used to be written down on paper, now we have it in tablets and cell phones, doesn't matter. It is still a letter unless the Spirit makes it alive. And the letter of the law kills, but the Spirit quickens, the Spirit makes alive. We want to live by the Spirit of the Word, and that's what Jesus lived by. He heard the voice of the Father by the Spirit and walked in perfect obedience. And as a result of that, he knew with confidence, great confidence. I like the verse, I'm not going to go there, but over there, when Lazarus was raised from the dead, when Jesus prayed outside the tomb, Jesus said, "I thank you, O Father, that you hear me and that you always hear me." This is so critical for us to have this confidence, to know that God hears us. We're looking for the perfect will of the Father to be done here on the earth. This is what's going to bring peace. This is the Prince of Peace that's being made known today in living reality, in walking, breathing, talking, the very purposes of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "I am the true vine and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my word abides in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. So John was speaking the very words of Jesus, saying, if you abide in me, Jesus said, if you abide in my spirit. We had the Holy Spirit today as a teacher to lead us unto all truth, but we have to honor the Spirit. We have to abide in the Spirit. We have to live our lives according to the Spirit. We have to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God, and in due time he'll exalt us. As we're found low in him according to the flesh, he raises us up by the Spirit that we might walk in perfect obedience. He gives us power to lay down our lives. Jesus made it evident. He said, no man takes my life from me, but I lay it down freely of my own accord. And he'd been given power by the Holy Spirit to lay it down. We're being given power today to lay down our life that the Lord might be manifest in our mortal flesh. That's abiding in the vine, abiding in Jesus, that we might bear fruit of the Spirit, not the fruit of the carnal nature that brings death and destruction, but the fruit of the new nature of Christ, of the living Word of God, that we might bring forth fruit, righteousness, peace, the very glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. If anyone sees his brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, he will ask, and he will give him life for those who commit sin not leading to death. This is echoed again and again in the scripture. If we see people that are sick, if we see people that are have been under the influence of the curse of the enemy, the Lord has given us power to pray. Again, we're not to go off on our own tangents and be led by our emotions. You know, Jesus had plenty of opportunities to be led by human emotion, but he refused to do so. The enemy found nothing in him. He couldn't be swayed by the carnal nature. He stayed in the purposes and the plan of God, regardless of what the desires of his flesh or the desires of the flesh that was around him. When Lazarus had become very sick and ill unto death, Jesus had an opportunity to go immediately. And it would have seemed like fleshly wisdom. I think the disciples were ready to go right then, but Jesus waited, the scripture said. Then after Lazarus was dead, Jesus said, now we're going to go. He's asleep. And they said, well, if he's already asleep, if he's dead, what's the point of going? See, there was another purpose that God had ordained for Jesus to walk in that instant. And it wasn't just for Jesus to go and heal Lazarus. There was greater glory to come forth. But he had to be obedient unto the Father and wait until Lazarus had actually died. And then he was able to go and perform a greater miracle than they had ever seen before and raise a man that had been dead 4 days up to life again. And this was the purpose, to show forth the perfect obedience to the Father. And of course, that's where Jesus prayed. I'm glad that you always hear me, Father. And I'm not praying for your sake or for my sake, because I know that you hear me, but I'm praying for the sake of the people that they might believe that you've sent me. We're a witness to the world that God has sent us in Christ Jesus to be reconcilers unto him, to reconcile the world through Christ unto God. But we can't go off on our own tangents, even with our good intentions. We have to wait on the Lord and trust that he has a purpose in all that he does, though we may not understand it. So he says, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we see a brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, he will ask, he will give him life for those who commit sin not leading unto death. Well, James says in the 5th chapter of his book, is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let him pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Thanks be unto God. The Lord has given us power even to pray for the forgiveness of sins. That which we remit in the earth is remitted in the heavens. And that which we pray for is done according to the will of God. That which we see the Father doing in the heavens, we do in the earth. And we manifest the glory of the life of the Son of God here in the flesh, just as he did when he walked the shores of Galilee. The Lord has given us power to pray. He's given us grace and authority and a confidence that we can ask when we know it's the will of the Lord. And we have to learn these things. This is not something that comes natural to us. This is where there's an exercise where we begin to understand and learn the purposes and the nature of the Lord and the voice of the Spirit so that we walk according to the promptings of the Lord rather than according to the desires of our own flesh, even when those desires look right. John says there is a sin leading to death. I do not say that he should pray about that. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is sin not leading to death. Jesus said, therefore I say unto you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven men. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him, but whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him, either in this age or in the age to come. These are hard to be understood scriptures, and many have wrestled with them, and pretty soon we have an idea that there's an unpardonable sin that God will never forgive. Well, I can tell you right now, the Lord came to bring peace. He is the Prince of Peace, and he came to bring total restoration and salvation. So he will bring every enemy underfoot. That means there won't be one sin left that hasn't been forgiven in the end. Praise be unto God. In truth be told, Jesus forgave it all at the cross. He did a full work at the cross. But we are now appropriating, we are now bringing into manifestation those things that Jesus did, but we're doing it according to his plan, according to his will, and according to his timing. And we can't run ahead of the Lord. The Lord has an order. There's the first fruits, and then it goes on to the full harvest. We're in the day of the first fruits. That means we don't get to run off on a tangent and just bring in everything that we desire. We have to wait on the Lord and go according to his plan. Therefore, in this age, and Jesus used the word age, you can sin against the Holy Spirit. Here in Acts, we can see a perfect example of what Jesus and John are talking about, a sin unto death. Now, a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property with his wife's full knowledge. He kept back a part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died, and great fear seized all who heard what had happened. There is a seemingly harshness through the Holy Spirit, and we see the Holy Spirit as a dove, and surely he is, but he's also the fire. The presence of God is a living, consuming fire, and the Holy Spirit is fire. We're baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire. Yes, peace, yes, joy, yes, love, but also the divine vengeance of God against all disobedience. And just because we live in the age of grace, of the grace of the Lord, it doesn't mean that there's not retribution. I think this was a perfect example in the ushering in of the new covenant, that here was a man and his wife that sinned against the Holy Spirit, that lied to God through the Holy Spirit, blasphemed the Holy Spirit, and their lives were taken from them. It was both Ananias and his wife. The two are one flesh. The two went out together. The two had conspired against the Holy Spirit, and the Lord ended their natural life. And it was the Lord. And the disciples and Peter did not choose to pray for them and ask that that sin would be forgiven in this age. Now, thanks be unto God that we see that God is working beyond just this age, yea, beyond even this natural life. The Lord is able to work beyond the grave. Some might question these things, but I tell you, the Lord gives us the unction of the Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth. Peter said, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust." This is Peter 3:18. "The just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive by the Spirit." And I might just say, Paul also wrote at one point about those that were fornicating, those that were sinning against their own bodies. And he said, "Hand this man who does these things over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit might be saved on the day of the Lord." Hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. Now, we can look at that on two different planes. First, there's the nature of the flesh. The flesh is the appetites, the desires, the will of the carnal nature that leads us into the way of temptation. And as we yield to the temptation, it bears fruit unto death in our life. And that's a law that God has put in the earth. And that law is still working today. If you sow unto your flesh, you're going to reap corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, you're going to reap life. That's the law of the Spirit. And that has not been done away with because Christ died on the cross. That's still very much working today. Hallelujah. But thank God, the Lord is able to do a work beyond the flesh. So even though Paul said, "Deliver this man to Satan," God created the waster to destroy, not to take the spirit, but to take the nature of Adam and do away with it, that we might be found in the nature of Christ. And this work goes beyond the grave. It doesn't mean necessarily the destruction of the natural flesh, though in the example of Ananias and Sapphira, it was. They actually died in this life. They died to the flesh. And I believe there does come a point, and we could prove this out with examples in our day, where when people have come to a certain place of sin in their lives, God no longer deals with them on this plane anymore. And they go to the grave in this natural life, and they go on. Now, and God can deal with them in the age to come or in the life to come. In the case of Paul talking about delivering one to Satan, I believe it wasn't necessarily that his life would be destroyed and then he'd go to hell for the destruction of his flesh. I believe that it was the destruction of the fleshly nature, and he was going to be cast out for a season. He was going to be put outside of the life and the presence of the Lord for a season, so that the destroyer, so that the enemy of the flesh could do its work and put an end to it, that he might be reconciled to God through the Spirit. And that's what that scripture says. And Peter, recognizing this work of the Lord, says that Jesus, he also suffered in his flesh and was put to death in his flesh and made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient. Then once the divine long-suffering waited in the day of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight souls, were saved through water. This was a preaching that Jesus did after his death, burial, and resurrection and ascension. He went into the lower parts of the earth, into hell itself, where these spirits that were disembodied spirits way back to the days of Noah, who had been disobedient to the preaching of Noah. And Noah did preach. Noah preached that there was a way of salvation, that they could get into the ark and be saved from the flood. This is really a picture or a foretaste of that which we preach in this day. You can get into Christ, you can get into the true ark today, and you can be saved from the flood of destruction that's coming on the world according to the flesh. Not that there will ever be again a literal flood. That was a type and a symbol of that which is in this day, the iniquity and the unrighteousness and the wrath of God that's poured out upon all unregenerated flesh. There is a way. There's a way of escape that the Lord has made. We get into the Lord Jesus Christ. But here, even in this picture, and if that was a picture of the natural, and these men that were disobedient in the days of Noah were put to death in the flesh through the flood, Jesus went and preached to them in their spiritual form, in hell, so to speak, or in the place of bondage in darkness of the grave, and he went and preached to them the gospel, the good news of salvation, that which he accomplished on the cross, and the life of the resurrection, that they might attain unto the resurrection from the dead. Praise be unto God. And if he did that for them, I have full confidence that he's going to do that for everyone that sins in this age, the sin that we're not to pray for. And there is a sin. We're not going to identify these things according to the natural. This is for mature people that are led by the Spirit. We're not to just pray for everything that we desire. We're to wait on the Lord and allow him to lead us how to pray. And sometimes it may seem heartless, but we're not to be led by our own desires and our own cares and our own emotional attachments. We're to be led by the Spirit, knowing that God has a purpose, and in the end, his desire and his will be performed, is to save all humanity. Hallelujah. And he will go into hell. If you make your bed in hell, he'll be there with you. Doesn't mean that your life in this natural life won't be taken. You can press yourself only so far in disobedience to the Holy Spirit, and sooner or later, the Lord may take you off of this natural plane in this age. But fear not, the Lord's mercy is everlasting. Praise God. And he's able to come and bring you up from the place of destruction and fit you again for the kingdom and the righteousness of the Lord according to his marvelous grace in Jesus Christ. We thank you today for joining us in the good news.